I will take 15-20 minutes to tell you how to live almost forever.
Okay.
So I'm sure that you don't have that high expectation. So first, I'm going immediately to reveal what SUR2A is. So SUR2A is a regulatory subunit of ATP-sensitive potassium channels. So ATP-sensitive potassium channels are ion channels that are important in pancreas, where they regulate insulin secretion, but they are also present in the heart. So in the heart, regulatory subunit is SUR2A, and it's physically associated with pore-forming subunit KIR6.2. So together, these two subunits form functional channel. So defining attributes of KTP channel is their selective permanence towards potassium, and also their regulation by intracellular ATP. So this is a very nice patch clamp electrophysiological recording in which you can see that ATP, intracellular ATP, blocks the activity of this channel because of being selective permeable for potassium. And because it is regulated by intracellular ATP, it has been termed ATP-sensitive potassium channel. And it has been viewed as a membrane conductance that link intracellular metabolism with membrane excitability. So what is the reason why we are focused on SUR2A? Because SUR2A is like adjunct subunits. It's not pore-forming subunits. It's not the main subunit. And this is the classical structure of KTP channel, in which four subunits of SUR and four subunits of KIR6.2 would form one functional ion channel. So in the time even before real-time RT-PCR exists, what we have done, just a control experiment. Because we used interchangeably male and female experimental animals, one day I said, okay, let's see if there is any different gender-specific difference between males and females in ATP-sensitive potassium channels. And what we have done, ordinary RT-PCR and have found that there is more SUR2A in female than male hearts. So the thing is that KIR6.2 was the same, pore-forming subunits were the same, but SUR2A, it was more in females than in males. We didn't know exactly what it means, because the first time somebody has seen that there is changes in the regulatory subunits alone, but not in pore-forming subunits. But when we have done some functional experiments, we have noticed that female cardiomyocytes are more resistant to stress than male cardiomyocytes. And we thought, is this just epiphenomenon that has nothing to do with SUR2A, or is it a consequence of SUR2A? So what we have done next, we have generated transgenic mice that overexpressed just SUR2A. So these mice had a moderately increased level of SUR2A all throughout the body, because the construct was linked to CMV promoter, all tissues had increased SUR2A. However, I have to say that SUR2A forms KTP channel only in three tissues, and this is heart, skeletal muscle, and brain. So we have generated this mice, and it was moderate overexpression. It means it was 4 to 10 times higher expression than in the wild type. So it was not as usual. It might happen that this is overexpression like 100 times, 500 times, 1,000 times. It was just 4 to 10 times. And what was nice is that mice were phenotypically unchanged. If you look at them, it was not possible to distinguish which one is wild type, which one is transgene. Also, hearts were not have not been different. But then, when we look into little bit function, we have found that cardiomyocytes overexpressing SUR2A are more resistant to hypoxia than wild type ones. Okay. And we have also found that hearts overexpressing SUR2A are more resistant to ischemia reperfusion than the wild type ones. So this is the measurement of size of myocardial infarction. So in wild type, ischemia reperfusion that will induce slightly over 20% of necrosis. In transgenes, it would induce around 5%. So there was substantial difference between two types. And these are literate controls. But also what we have found when you look a little bit in vivo, we have found that mice increased SUR2A have much increased physical endurance. So this graph shows tolerated workload. So this is obtained by some complex formula in which you have to include the weight of animal and these sorts of things. But because animals between wild type and overexpressing animal, transgenic animals, there was no any significant difference. You can also look into time of that these animals have been able to be on the treadmill. This is not just ordinary treadmill that goes flat. It is treadmill that was on a slope to make it difficult. So normal wild type mice would go 40 minutes. The ones that are overexpressing SUR2A were around 100 minutes. So how we were able to establish the exact time, it is pretty much a well-defined methodology. So definitely mice that went 40 minutes couldn't go longer, and definitely mice that were 100 minutes couldn't go any longer. And also, we have found that behind hypoxia, oxygenation, etc., increase in SUR2A would increase resistance to other types of stresses like beta adrenergic stress in this particular case. So then what we have discovered by serendipity once. So I had a committee meeting. It was ethical committee meeting about animals, project licensing, licenses and these sort of things. And I was a member of the committee sitting with a veterinarian from the research unit. And he said to me, do you know that your mice are the talk of the unit? And I said, what mice? And he said, you know those mice that don't die. And then what happened? We went back, we went to unit, and we realized that we forgot about 2 cages of mice. Okay. I mean, because we were doing thousands and thousands of mice, so 2 cages remain untouched. And then the staff, you know, they're feeding them every day, every day, every day, and there is a natural, you know, process of dying of mice. However, these guys were not dying. And then I said, okay, let them go until they naturally die. Because this kind of study are relatively rare because they're very expensive because of animal maintenance. So what we got was at the end, when animals naturally died, we got that their average was slightly less than 1,200 days. And it was pretty consistent. They have done pretty well. So this is comparison with the wild type, and this is comparison with SUR2A. So this is the mice that would normally die of this background in this unit. Because that was not for aging study unit, it was normal unit. Mice were under normal condition. So approximately 60% lifespan was longer in this smaller cohort of animals. So then we look how it to compare to other studies, to other aging studies. So first we looked for a strain. This is the strain that lives the longest. C57BLKSJ is the strain that is wild type, but it has the longest lifespan. So on average, they are a little bit below 1,000 days. And then there are some transgenic interventions, like this one, mTOR, a knockout mice, that had extension to 28 months. Just these mice were midgets, so phenotypically they were clearly different from the wild type. So they are approximately, I would say, at the level of, because 1200 is slightly less than 3 years, or around 3 years. So this guy is world record holder in mice world, okay. And this is he lived 1472 days. So in terms of documentation, this is the longest living mouse documented ever. So this was a mouse that was a knockout of growth hormone receptors. Okay, so he was a midget again. So he was midget, and his name was Yoda. Okay, his name was Yoda. And this is female mouse, okay, that lived with this male mouse. And the purpose is to make him company and to keep him warm. So this is pretty standard procedure in aging studies and lifespan studies. Okay, lifespan studies. Okay.
Does this apply to humans as well?
Absolutely, absolutely. That's the point. So can you guess what the name of this female companion was?
Princess Leia.
Princess Leia, that's true. Good guess. Princess Leia. Yoda. And Princess Leia. Okay, so when we compared our mice with this guy, we said, okay, they're doing pretty well. Okay, so they're like, they died 5 months younger, but still they were not midgets. And phenotypically they were beautiful. They were good looking mice. And then we looked a little bit what's going on during aging. Are there any issues with level in SUR2A? Okay, so as I said, there are three tissues where SUR2A is recognized to potentially be important as a part of KTP channels. And this is heart, skeletal muscle, and brain. We have measured in heart and skeletal muscle, we didn't do brain. So what we have found is that in aging, I mean, this is cycle threshold of real-time RT-PCR, so more is actually less. So during aging, and this, what is termed here is young, is around 2 to 3 months old animal. What is termed as old is around 22 months old animal. So what is here is that other subunits didn't change during aging. However, SUR2A in the heart, and that was similarly in skeletal muscle, went down. So our estimate was that the old mice has approximately 40% of SUR2A levels of young mice. And then we have looked the same thing in transgenic animals. So in transgenic animals, it was a little bit lower, but it wasn't statistically significantly lower. So they kind of maintained SUR2A levels in the heart. So when we looked functionally in terms of resistance to hypoxia, we have found that old cells are more sensitive to hypoxia than the young cells. And also, we have found that to begin with, young cells of transgenic animals were better protected than from the wild type. And also, in all the transgenic animal, there was slightly increased sensitivity, but it was not hugely different. In terms of physical endurance, what was striking was, so this is wild type. So older animals were less physically endurant, did not perform that well as young animals. However, in transgenic, physical endurance is much higher to begin with, and then it decreased during aging. But when I looked at a graph like this, what was striking was that old transgenic animal demonstrated a better physical performance and had more physical endurance than young wild-type animals. So, and this result, I mean, not just physical endurance, but this SUR2A dynamics has been confirmed in recent, relatively recent, 2 years old Nature paper that they have used SUR2A as a parameter of cardiac aging, and they heavily relied on our data, and they repeated them experimentally in this paper. We have done a lot of experiments to know to analyze the mechanism, and we have done some fine experiments to do the mechanism, so we have a pretty good idea. So I'm not going to talk about the mechanism because it is kind of hardcore biochemistry. But we have this result is that I would like to show you, because it is something that is totally out of logic, totally unexpected, and I would say unusual. So what we have done, we have infected embryonic hearts with adenovirus containing SUR2A construct. Okay. And then what we have found that in infected embryonic hearts, markers of stem cells increased. So it seems that SUR2A put the heart towards less differentiated state. And when we look a little bit in signaling, we have found that SUR2A would inhibit ERK, which is the main factor regulating differentiation and even cellular aging. So simply speaking, I would say that SUR2A, increased level of SUR2A, would make these cells younger. Whether this has anything to do with what we have observed in vivo, I don't know. Whether this would happen if cardiomyocytes were adult, also I don't know. So now, everything is nice, however, we want to therapeutically exploit this. Okay, so what we want is to increase SUR2A, to find a way to increase SUR2A. So there is one approach that I love, okay, and this is gene therapy approach. And unfortunately, we didn't do much there. Okay, and the reason why we didn't do much there is because usually when you, particularly in the past, when you write up a grant about gene therapy, a funding body would go, don't touch it. So we have generated adenovirus. We have even generated lentovirus that would potentially do lifelong expression. I mean, my idea was, I thought that SUR2A is perfect for secondary prevention of coronary heart disease. I thought I thought a patient that would go to a cardiac bypass surgery, you can just inject them with SUR2A and improve their chance later. And we have done at the cellular level cardiomyocytes with adenoviral constructs, and we have seen that indeed infection with SUR2A would increase resistance of these cells to ischemia. So this was what we have done. Although we had some application, there was one great Spanish group that I loved, and they have invented new method of delivery of gene to the heart. So we tried, and we're still trying to put things together to combine both things and make it happen. Another possible strategy is to find the compounds that would activate signaling pathways that upregulate SUR2A. So in order to find compounds that would activate signaling pathways to upregulate SUR2A, you first have to know what are signaling pathways that regulate SUR2A. So what we have done, we have checked many different factors and different things. But one of the things that we have noticed is that in vitro hypoxia upregulates SUR2A. And this was so-called mild hypoxia. You can see this is 21% of oxygen, and this is that would be 13% of oxygen. So under in vitro conditions, for in vitro cellular culture, that is considered to be mild hypoxia. And we have found that indeed there is increase of SUR2A, and there is also functional consequence of this increase. So these are two things that we have. We have also done in vivo. So we have found that, so for example, this is experiments at 21 and mice that were held at 18% oxygen tension. So this is slightly lower than the mountain in Cyprus, prodromos. So prodromos, I think the highest prodromos is around 1400 meters. I think this is little, yeah. So this is correct. So this is 18% is around 1100. Okay, so you are in prodromos, so this is 80%. So these are levels, I mean, these are levels in the heart. So what we have found there, that at 80% there are no effects on ATP. However, lactate goes up, LDH goes up, and also NAD goes up, and NADH goes down. Okay, so there are some subtle changes. And the effect on this oxygen tension was massive. So it was massive increase of SUR2A at this level of hypoxia. So when we have looked a little bit in vitro, okay, we realized that it seems that NAD-NADH ratio seems to regulate SUR2A. So when in vitro, in cell culture, we would change the ratio in favor of NAD, we would get increase in SUR2A. And now we said to ourselves, how to regulate NAD-NADH ratio? Let's sit down, go through the papers, and let's see papers and people who have done research looking into NAD-NADH ratio in different tissues. And we have found these guys. Okay, so this is old paper from Journal of Nutrition. So what they have done in this journal, they have looked, they have taken vitamin B3, feed mice with vitamin B3, and looked for NAD-NADH ratio in all tissues, liver, kidneys, heart, brain, whatever. And they have found that nicotinamide peros would increase NAD and NADH. But also, all forms of vitamin D, also nicotinic acid, would do the same. So what we have done, we have start feeding mice with nicotinamide. Okay. But that was design of this experiment was crucial. Okay, so we have ordered food from special diet services in UK. Okay. And we ordered one, let's say, control food that was not spiked with a nicotinamide. And then five different levels of spiking of nicotinamide. Okay, that would we have estimated what is the average intake of food of a mouse that used in libido, and then we have estimated the amount of nicotinamide that would be taken. So we went from a low amount to pretty much mammoth amounts. Okay, so that was the range. And everything we have given, all six big, it was, I think, I mean, it was tens of kilograms per, it was bags, big bags of food. And each of those six bags, one control and five different others, were distributed by staff in the resource unit. I didn't know what mice are getting. Postdocs didn't know what mice are getting. Staff didn't know what are they giving, because it was labeled 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 6. Okay. And then we got, we have done our stuff, our experiments. And in principle, we have found that nicotinamide did increase SUR2A in the heart and in the skeletal muscle. So this is, although it looks little, it is a pretty decent increase. It is like 10 times increase in the heart. And also, it did mimic some of crucial effects of increased SUR2A. It mimic cardioprotection. So hearts were more resistant to ischemia reperfusion. And also, it mimic physical endurance. Whether it would mimic the effect on lifespan, we don't know at the moment. However, having said that, I have done a lot of comparison of nicotinamide effect in preclinical study and comparing with clinical trials. Preclinical study on rodents, particularly on mice. So in principle, things were first discovered. So clinically, it is used, the nicotinamide is used to large doses for head and neck cancer. So first, that was found out in mice, and then it was transferred to people, to humans, so it is in use. Also, similarly for diabetes mellitus. So in principle, preclinical studies in mice were pretty valid for humans. And here we have two major features of nicotinamide. I didn't show here, but we have done studies that tied the effect of nicotinamide with SUR2A. So if you remove SUR2A as a factor, this effect cannot be produced. So now, as I said, crucial thing is was in doses. So when we have done our mice feeding and doses and everything, then we have calculated in human doses how much it would be if human, how much human should get. And that was not simple calculation. It is based on a relatively new formula that 6-7 years ago has been developed and published in FASEB journal. So it is complex, it's not just based on weight, but it is pretty much. So what we have found, that very low doses or low doses of nicotinamide would work. Okay, so what we have described in terms of cardioprotection and what we have described in terms of physical endurance, it could be mimicked with something that is equivalent of 100 milligrams per day of nicotinamide. Nicotinamide belongs to the safest group of compounds. Okay, so now what is the problem? Nicotinamide belongs to the safest group of compounds in according to FDA. It doesn't have almost any adverse effects, and adverse effects starting to appear when doses over 3 grams per day. We are now at the level of 100 milligrams. All therapeutic effects, all therapeutic doses that are used, let's say for acne, for diabetes, etc., are between 500 milligrams and 3 grams. So this is a very low dose. So if, based on preclinical study, if you take orally 100 milligrams per day of nicotinamide, you have chance to mimic the effect that we have found in mice. If you mimic the effect that we have on mice, your life expectancy will jump, let's say, from 80 to 128 years.
Yeah, so will I still look like Yoda at the end?
No, because Yoda is a knockout of growth hormone receptor. And Yoda is, that is our point, that you are going to look beautiful. And healthy part is that you can see based on physical endurance that although they are old, they are physical endurance. Again. So now the problem. I mean, it's not the problem, but it is perceived the problem. The problem with for you getting good nicotinamide, okay, and the problem for funding bodies to fund this is because there is another form of vitamin B3 that is called nicotinic acid. This form is prevalent predominant form. It is form that is used in 95-99% preparation of vitamin B3s. So if you buy a multivitamin complex, you are going to have as vitamin B3 nicotinic acid. If you go to the internet to buy a vitamin B3 or to buy nicotinamide, you have to search very hard and to be very careful that you buy exactly nicotinamide and not nicotinic acids or niacin, etc. So the difference is that pharmacological profile is different. Maybe you remember that nicotinic acids was prototype of statins because it has an anti-lipid effect and it has a vasodilator effect. So the thing is that nicotinic acid has these two effects, particularly vasodilator effect that is undesirable, and also it is hepatotoxic, which nicotinamide seems to have. So did I put my money where my mouth is? Okay. I am feeding with this my mother, okay? I didn't kill her yet, okay? She has heart failure, okay? Like now 10 years. And giving her this one, and she is still alive, and she is closing on 86, okay? And, you know. So if any of you would like to start embarking on this course, I will wait for you 20 years, and then you can report me back how it was. Okay, so this is my advice. So my conclusion,
is based on our experimental data. SUR2A seems to regulate cardiac resistance to stress, regulate physical endurance, regulate cardiac aging, regulate stem cell differentiation, regulate lifespan. Also, it is possible to regulate SUR2A levels safely and efficiently. And I have to acknowledge this first. This research was supported by all mainstream funding bodies in UK, and also these are people that bled together with me and have done this job by their hands.